What's up, everybody? It's January. This is the time of the year everybody wants to work out and get fit. So the giveaway today is free access to MAPS Anabolic. Here's how you can win, okay? In the first 24 hours that we drop this episode, underneath, leave a comment and talk about what you plan on doing for fitness this month. How are you going to get started? How are you going to change things? Do you have new goals? Or maybe you don't have any new goals. Maybe you've been doing this the whole time like a champion. Doesn't matter. Leave a comment below in the first 24 hours. Also, subscribe to this channel and turn on notifications. Got to do all those things. And if you do those and we pick your comment, we'll notify you and you get free access to MAPS Anabolic. Also, we got this huge promotion. It's obviously January. Like I just said, everybody likes to work out in January. So here's what we're doing for everybody. We put together three workout bundles, one for a beginner, another one for someone who's intermediate, and another one for people who are advanced. And in these bundles, we've taken MAPS programs, multiple MAPS programs, and put them together specific to those goals that I just talked about. 9 months of exercise programming in each bundle, okay? So it's perfect for the whole year. And we discounted them heavily for the month of January. So if you're interested, you want to check this out, you want to see what the sale is and what's going on, you got to go to, let's see, mapsjanuary.com. That's right. So mapsjanuary.com, and you can check all this out. Also, for those of you who just want to get one program and you want to start with the flagship program, MAPS Anabolic, that's 50% off right now. All you got to do is use the code January50 for that discount. All right? Here comes the show. Stop trying to burn more calories to lose weight. It's a losing strategy.
No pun intended.
Stop it.
Yeah, I said it, boys. So that's it. You know, to elaborate a little bit, it's trying to burn calories manually to create a calorie deficit, right? Mm. So in order to lose weight, you have to burn more calories than you take in. And so people take that burn more calories side and they say, well, I'm just going to move a lot more to burn more calories. But it's a losing strategy because there's two reasons. One, it's really hard to burn calories, really easy to eat them, right? Yeah. So like how many calories is like in a Coke? What is that, 200 something, 300?
That's about right, 180.
180 mm-hmm. calories in a can
yeah,
of Coke?
That's like, it's been a while since I looked at back.
That's a good 30 to 40 minutes of vigorous cardiovascular activity. Right. So it's like a lot of work and eating those calories is super, or drinking them super easy.
Was that close, Doug?
150 calories, 140 ooh, yeah. For classic.
Yeah. Oh, very good. The second reason is the manual... The trying to burn calories manually by moving more, your body really adapts to that really well. And we see that in studies where people try to lose weight with, if that's their attempt without diet, it just doesn't happen.
You know who loves to push this message the most, I feel, is like tech companies, because, you know, it's so mathematical the way they think about fitness, especially. This is what drives me crazy. Yeah. And because they have those numbers, right? They have the stats of like, there's this many calories and this type of food. And if you just burn this amount of calories, you know, everything's going to be solved and you're going to lose weight. And they're not considering all the human behaviors that go along with it.
Yeah. Well, what's the adaptation time for cardio? Isn't it like 2 weeks or less? It's pretty fast.
That's what the certification said.
Right. In comparison to resistance training, which I think the estimation was somewhere between 6 and 8 weeks or somewhere around there. And I think that the cardio was like two. In other words, it takes your body a lot longer to adapt to modalities like weight training, mm-hmm. which that in itself are going to give you benefits for burning calories. And then when you do something like cardio, and I know it's not accurate, but I used to explain to a client that, okay, so pretend you get on this machine and run for an hour and let's pretend it's accurate and it burned, you know, 300 calories. Well, the next time you get on it, it burns 280 and with the same amount of effort and same amount of time. And now it's burning 280, then 250, then 200. Well, now, I know that doesn't translate
your body
to be
just,
exact.
Yeah, it gets more efficient at what it does. And so they don't factor that in. It's like if you keep, you know, throwing the same type of stress at the body wants to get better at it. So it doesn't have to burn that many calories.
Yeah. More importantly, forget that you become efficient while doing the activity, which is true. You get better at it. The real issue is how the body adapts overall. You end up getting this kind of like your metabolism adjusts, your activity levels adjust, your appetite adjusts to balance the things out. The best study we have on this are done on modern hunter-gatherers. It's a study I've quoted many times that there's others that where they actually went and studied modern hunter-gatherers who move a lot, way more than most Westerners, way more. And they found that they burned roughly the same amount of calories. Now, the difference with something like resistance training is resistance training, forget the calories burned, it teaches your body to burn more calories on its own. So a faster metabolism is different than what I'm talking about, right? What I'm talking about is I got to get up and move to burn these calories. A faster metabolism is your body's just burning more calories on its own, which is a much more effective strategy.
Well, since we're talking about manually burning calories, what do you guys think about McDonald's new move with the recumbent bikes and the restaurants? Have you guys seen this?
So what is that? Do you have to ride it?
No, you don't have to do anything. They're replacing some of the seating. I believe China did it first, and I thought I saw it coming to Chicago. I know for sure it's in China. Okay. And they're like, where it would be a table setting. So instead of it being a table where you would eat, and it's just got pedals, and you're pedaling while you eat.
This is like a beta tested like idea, or are they like really trying to roll this out to all the locations?
I don't know how many total. Maybe Doug can find out how many total. I know it started in China. Uh-huh. I believe I read too that Chicago was adopting it. Some of them over there, I think. And I don't know if this is like, let's test it and see it, or this is going to be something they're going to be permanently doing.
Well, I have two opinions on it. One is, and I do want to be clear.
There it is right there.
Yeah.
See?
Oh yeah. I saw that. There's a meme going around with this.
Oh really?
Yeah. Which I've seen this.
It sounds ridiculous to me.
So I have two kind of opinions on it. One is, you know, I know earlier I said, you know, trying to burn manual calories to lose weight is a losing strategy. No pun intended. That doesn't mean there aren't health benefits, though. So you're still going to get health benefits from being more active. So if you sit on a recumbent bike while you eat your fast food, you are going to get better health benefits from that. If you use it, you'll get a better insulin response. Your body's going to uptake the sugars and the calories a little bit better. You're not going to be as inflamed, maybe from the inflammatory effects of the food. Then the other opinion I have is that I think this is going to be a total bust because nobody cares. Like
nobody's going to McDonald's for that.
Yeah, it's like it's novelty. Like you might at first see people doing it because they check this out. But then have you ever wanted to ride and move while you eat anything?
No. I mean, it's an interesting idea. Like I actually do think that it's all positive. I don't see anything negative about it, right? I don't see it being anything wrong or bad with it. Unfortunately, to your point, I don't think I see anyone sticking with it. And I don't see anyone going like, hey, let's go to McDonald's and have a burger and ride a bike. Like, I don't see that happening. And like you said, I think people will sit on it, try it out. Oh, this is kind of fun. And I actually think it would be great because I think it'll take, we talk about this all the time, right? When you're eating, we have this tendency to be chewing on one bite, but already getting ready to stuff our face with
the
other.
You're thinking about the food that's not even in your mouth.
Right. So you're constantly doing that. Whereas if you're kind of pedaling, I think maybe you're not so distracted. Maybe you're more present because you're having to
move. I'm so tired. I need more McFlurry. Yeah.
I don't know. I think it's novelty. I think people are going to be like, this looks kind of cool. And then that's it.
It's a weird strategy there for McDonald's.
What's up, Doug?
I feel like they're bulletproofing themselves. They're like protecting themselves from more criticism.
Well, one thing it does do is charge your phone. So that may be a reason people do it.
Oh, I see.
So there's that benefit.
Really?
Yeah.
Speaking of phone, did you guys see the Tesla phone?
No.
No, I haven't.
Bro, so pull it up, Doug. Pull it up.
What is Tesla not doing? Because I still hear that they're coming out with the robot. You know, they're coming out with like all kinds of new crazy things.
If anybody's going to disrupt that market or Apple's stranglehold on the culture around phones, it's Tesla. Mm-hmm. It's Musk. Elon Musk.
Tesla phone.
Like, okay, think about it this way. Steve Jobs, right? He's passed away, but his legacy lives on and he's got a cult-like follower. At least Apple does, right? The only other person that I could see that could challenge that is someone like Elon Musk. He's got the same celebrity.
So this is interesting. So do you think that, because you know Apple is trying to make an electric car and roll that out, right? So it's like they're kind of towing their foot in his, waters versus now he's trying to make a phone.
I've always said,
which one do you think is going to be more successful?
I always have said that like this is how billionaires just fuck with each other. Like, all right, you're gonna fucking get in my move in my space. I'm gonna get into your space just to fuck with each other.
What are the specs? So,
dude, has like four cameras on it. You can video and shoot at the same time. It takes up the entire surface of the phone, so there's no edge like iPhone or the Google phone have. Like, so it's completely all screen. Uh-huh. It can be charged solar.
Now that is cool.
How cool is that? Really cool. So the back of it is like a solar panel. So like lay it on your dashboard, let the sun charge your phone.
You're never supposed to leave your phone in the sun.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense.
I mean, why haven't they done that?
Wow.
I know. So it looks It looks cool.
Yeah, maybe it was a heating issue, you know, why they haven't rolled that out.
Yeah, you know, okay, so again, if you look at, and I have family members that are in, like, super into tech. My son is, like, a big, he loves this kind of stuff, and he's always talking crap about Apple and, oh, God, the other phones are so much better and so much, they have the better cameras, and Apple phone's camera came out, and, the Google ones use those way before. And he's right. If you hear people talk about these phones, Apple isn't the best in that sense. But what Apple has is like this cult-like following. It's like an accessory. I have an app.
Well, they have the best UI out of anything.
Yeah, but yes, it's got a good UI. But I think Tesla could, because it's Elon Musk, I think it's going
to
cause the most.
So yeah, okay, there's more to that though with Apple. So the other part of Apple, the UI, I think is one of the main reasons, and it's got that cool factor. But they have also, because they've built this kind of cult following and network of all the tools like speak to each other. Mm-hmm. Like there's not a lot of stuff that there's as many things like as Apple has, like mm-hmm. as your speakers and your series and all those things that are all speaking to each other, and everything connects, everything plugs in the same, charges.
It's all in-house.
Yeah. So yeah. It's like it's all uniform. Whereas the other stuff you might love a Google phone, but then you have another like, Alexa or something else, you know what I'm saying? So I feel like Apple did such a good job of allowing all their tech to speak to each other and recognize each other right away. Like, I like that part of it.
Yeah, and I mean, the software for Tesla is pretty, like, crazy. Like, the updates they can throw out to their vehicles and everything and, like, shoot that out. Like, so I think that they have the software capability that Apple does. It's just the experience, I think, they'll probably
They compete for employees all the time, right?
Yeah.
You guys know that?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So
all these companies do.
So I can't say too much because I don't want to get anybody in trouble. But yeah. I trained people that worked at high levels at both Apple
and Tesla. My niece, that's what she does, and she worked for Facebook, Google, and she's just now moved over to, I told you guys the other day, the largest company that's not public yet. It's slipping my mind right now. But she's a head recruiter or a big recruiter for them. And they're always like cherry picking each other's.
So employees. What these guys would tell me, my clients, and this was years ago. So you're talking like 7 years ago. Okay. Executives at Apple, executives at Tesla, train them both. And they would tell me that there was like a rivalry where mm-hmm. they would specifically go after
yeah.
people in each other's companies. So yeah. I had a client who, and again, I can't say too much, but was very high up in Apple, like very high up, gets recruited by Tesla. And then Apple went back and tried to recruit. And then Apple ended up recruiting someone else from Tesla. And it's like this war. So it's like this kind of this rivalry that maybe people aren't super aware of.
Oh, yeah.
And it's a great
rivalry. It's been there the whole time. Yeah, it's been definitely like sort of under wraps.
Dude, this is such a fun rivalry to think about. It's too bad Steve Jobs isn't here because could you imagine if we had Jobs and Musk?
Dude.
Like those are the two biggest powerhouse celebrity CEOs. Well,
and they both, like you said, have created kind of this cult-like following.
Total.
Look at the cult following in Tesla. I mean, Tesla, did you see they rolled out that whistle?
Tim Cook isn't getting
and
that
people are all buying a whistle. You know, it's just like a plain-ass whistle that everyone would be buying it because it's Tesla.
I keep eating my words with Tesla stock because if you look at the fundamentals, the price of the stock, this is coming from like from an investment perspective, makes no sense. However, you have someone like Elon Musk and what people think he's capable of, and the guy is entertaining and he's got that celebrity factor and he gets in Twitter battles with politicians and whatever. And so people are betting on him. They're 100% betting on him. And something like this makes me go, oh.
Well, I didn't see this coming. I mean, I with everything he's doing with SpaceX and the car, like it just
Neuralink.
I just did not see the phone coming, and then not only that, but the first one he's rolling out looks sick. It doesn't look like this is version one and it'll get better, I promise, in the future. It looks sick right out the gate, so it's going to be interesting to see how much of a share they take away from
Apple. I can't wait to see it. Yeah. Speaking of sick, so I got that cold or whatever that you had. So I was over the week or whatever, over the holiday. And so it made me sneeze, right? So I'm sneezing. And every time I sneeze, Jessica could be anywhere in the house and she'll jump out of her chair or whatever. The dad sneeze. You guys have heard of the dad sneeze?
Yeah.
So I saw this meme.
I scared Courtney this weekend, actually. Okay.
Courtney's jumped up.
So I saw this. So there was this meme that was going around. I thought it was hilarious. And it said something like, do men practice yelling when they sneeze when they're boys, or does it just happen as soon as they become dads, right? It's being shared like crazy. It's this thing that people say. When I was a kid, I remember my grandfather, now he's 90, right? But when I was a kid, it sounded like he yelled. So you'd hear him across the room, like that real loud. And me and my cousin would be like, oh, what the hell? Yeah. And of course, then you get older. And then now this is how I sneeze. My dad sneezes this way, super loud. So I was talking to Jessica about it. And I'm like, I think it's obviously a guy thing.
It's been modeled.
There's something about us men that whatever. She's like, it's sneezing male privilege. I said, what?
Sneezing male privilege.
She says, because you guys just don't think you need to hold it in. You just let it out like you roar. And then, so we had this debate and it was, you know, half joking, half whatever. Yeah. And so I said, honey, have you ever heard me sneeze in a restaurant? And then she had to think about it. I'm like, yeah, that's how you know it's not fake. Because if I'm in a restaurant, I'll bury my face, try to hold it, but it still comes out. Hurr! I just end up gritting my teeth through the whole thing. So
what is it? What is it that caused us to do that? Because I think
we're just bigger. I really do.
Because there's also like, I was tripping on that too, because like there's been some girls I've met who will sneeze and they'll be like a million sneezes like in a row.
That's
like,
Jessica.
I'm like, what just happened?
Yeah, that's Jessica. She goes, I'm like, let it out.
Yeah, it's like they're holding back because they don't want to just be out with it.
Yeah, but you're right though. There was a transition at one point in my life where it went from like probably a kid sneeze or a normal sneeze, and then all of a sudden I have this loud ass man sneeze. Like I don't even remember when that switch was, and I can't.
So we were having this debate, and we're having a good time with it. And she's like, and so she likes to use the evolutionary arguments with me to joke around.
Throws it right back at
you.
Yeah,
and she goes, I don't believe it's just men. I think you guys just don't feel as self-conscious about letting it out. I'm like, no, I don't know. I'm like, I can't control it. And she goes, how would this be evolutionary advantageous? You're out hunting and you sneeze and you scare away the freaking the gazelles.
Yeah.
I'm like, you're right.
Well,
like,
I don't know, but I mean, I feel like yawning's kind of similar too, or maybe it's just that I'm getting older. I make like a lot of more old man noises. You know, when I get up from sleeping, I'm like, and I'm just like really loud about everything. But yeah, it's funny because we were up in Truckee for New Year's Eve, and you know, the whole thing about like trying to stay up late for midnight.
I'm so over it.
It's just like one of those things. You're like, dude, really? Like, do we still have to do this? Like, you know, who came up with it? And I'm like, I sound like such an old man. Like, dude, sack it up. You know, you're in this, you know, for the long haul. It's it's funny because you know, Courtney's the same. Like, we're just kind of just end up not really going out and partying or anything, but we try and party and pretend to have a good time. And so she starts like, you know, getting low in her chair and is like kind of getting tired. I could tell. And I'm like, if you yawn, you're going to have to take a shot. And so it was this deal that we made. I'm like, every time like I catch her yawn, like she had to go take a shot. And like I had the kids watching her for me. You know, and I'm like, did mommy yawn? Yeah. And
so we hey, got kids, her help shot. Me get your mom drunk.
Dude, worked like a charm.
It did work like a charm. She ended up taking a few shots. I saw her come in the kitchen and had a couple shots.
She was way more fun after that.
You know what sucks about yawns is there's a social contagious aspect of it. So just saying the word yawn makes people more likely to yawn. So
do it right now, everybody's gonna yawn. Yeah, we're like, listening.
Yeah, we're all trying not to. It's one of those things. Yeah, they think it's because you're signaling to the people around you that you're tired. So it's like this social, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
But it's funny because you said that to her, probably made her yawn more.
Probably, huh?
Yeah. You ever do this when someone yawns? You ever mess with your buddies? They yawn. You stick your fingers in the mouth.
Oh, I used to do that. I would put my hand over their mouth.
Stick your fingers in my mouth.
No, you can't. So, you know, you're yawning, your mouth.
I would do that to mess with people. I'd put my hand over their mouth.
No, you can't bite down. So, and then they do this one. And you try to bite, but the yawn has to finish first. It's the best thing. Ew,
dude, that's messed up.
That's why it's so funny. Yeah. I love doing all that.
So, what did you end up? So, since you didn't come up with us, what did you end up doing for New Year's?
Okay. So, what happened? So, people don't know, right? So, we all planned on going up there, all of us together with our families. And it was, you know, we try and do this every year. And it was record snow, right? Record breaking?
Oh, back to back record storms.
Epic snow.
So, ridiculous. The roads on the way up got shut down. Tons and tons of snow. I couldn't stay as long as you guys because my older kids had to be back with their mom. So I only had to begin with a few days. They closed the roads, so I already lost a day. Mm-hmm. So my cousin says, why don't you come stay at our house, visit with us? They're up in Sacramento, so that's like a nice stopping point. It's about only an hour and a half away from, you know, where we would want to go. So we went up, stayed with my cousin and waited. They were closed again another day. And I was like, it's just not worth it for us to go up there because I'll only be there for a day or two. And then it was the conditions were already so bad that it would have taken me hours in the car with the baby and the whole deal. I'm like, oh, this totally sucks. So we stayed up there, hung out with my cousin and his kids, which is great. Got to visit with them. Got to eat at my uncle's restaurant, which I haven't done in a long time.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you guys have heard me talk about my uncle. So my uncle has a restaurant, shout out, Visconti's restaurant in Folsom. This is my my grandfather's brother.
Yeah.
The whole family works there.
Are we getting a kickback for this?
We're not. No sponsorship, but family, right? But if you go up there and you have food there, I guarantee my cousins or someone that knows me work there. So if you say, hey, I know Sal or whatever, they'll know who I am. But anyway, we went there, had a great meal, nice big Italian dinner. It was a good time.
You would get a kick out of what happened to us on the way up because I don't know what it is with me and gas.
You did not.
I'm glad you're bringing this up. Me and Courtney are like, how the hell did this happen?
Bro, you got a problem.
Listen to this, bro. Okay, so first of all, we flew all the way there until the last, I don't know.
The Colfax.
40 miles away from our house. And then the next 4 hours, I think it took us to get the rest of the way. So I have the distance till empty gauge, obviously, on my truck. And then I have Waze app in. And so we are 100 at one point where I'm looking at the gas before we head up the hill and I'm like, oh, we've got 140 miles left of gas and we only have 120 miles to go. We're cool. So I got 20 miles extra.
Plenty of extra miles.
Right? 20 extra miles.
I feel like that's cutting it close. Anyway, continue.
So I got 20 extra miles.
I don't get that. All right, go ahead.
Yeah, I got 20 extra miles. So, but then we sit in like parking lot traffic, right? And so I'm watching the idling of my truck just kind of slowly eat. And then it's going like, you know, from 120, 140, and then it's like, yeah, 115. It's like, it's getting lower and lower. And then now it's even. And it's like, oh shit, now we're going to barely make it there. And I'm like, okay, I need to stop and get gas. And so we're climbing the hill and we're now up in like elevation where there's snow already. And like the next, I tell Katrina, I'm like, well, we'll pull over on the next day. I'm also, mind you, I have a kid that's 2.5. So I'm also trying to time, you know, keeping him happy. And sure. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like try and time it with either changing a diaper or feeding time. Right. We, you know, whatever. So, okay, we have to get gas. And so we go to the next exit and there's a CHP that's blocking you from getting off. And so I'm like, shit, okay, we got to wait the next exit. And every time we have to wait an exit, it's like a 30, 45 minutes before the next exit because we're in like bumper to bumper traffic. And so I'm just like watching my gas go down slowly but surely, burning away. Every time, and then I get to the next exit, guess what happens? CHP blocking it off again. And I'm like, what the fuck? So go past that one. Another 30 minutes go by. Now I'm starting to get low gas. Like it's now getting to a point where I think I'm at 20 miles total or 25 miles total till I'm empty. So I'm like, okay, I have to get off the next exit. So I go to the next exit. CHP blocking. Wow. But at this point, I'm like,
do you know why they were doing that?
I pull over. So I gotta go talk to him. I pull over, jump out, I go run over the CHP and I go, hey, I have literally like 10 miles. I think I lied to him when I had like 15 or 20, but I told him, I have like 10 miles left of gas. And this is like one of the only gas stations for the next 20 something miles. I have to get gas here. He goes, you couldn't get gas here if you wanted. He goes, all the power's out everywhere. I'm like, well, what am I supposed to do? He goes, I don't know what to tell you. I'm like, and I offered, I said, do you have any gas? I'll pay you $100 for a 5 gallon tank. I said, I can't help you. And I'm like, you got to let me off. And he's like, even if I let you off, there's nothing that you can get off this exit. And I'm like, what am I supposed to do? I said, is it that way as we go further up? He goes, yeah, more likely most of those are all out. So I had to, he let me get off just so I could turn back around and I had to head all the way back down. So we had just been in parking lot traffic for like the last 2 hours and I had to go back.
I'm moving forward. I was like, yeah, I'm going back.
I had to go backtrack. And when I finally could get off on an exit, the first exit I get off is in Colfax. I get off there and the whole town is blacked out. Now I'm freaking out. I'm like on 5 miles left of gas and I just pulled over to get gas and it's blacked out. No. So I barely make it all the way back down. So I'm like 45 minutes back down the mountain of the 2.5 hours sitting in traffic to start all over and go back and it got gas, filled up, and then got back up.
So just so that people—
I can't believe you made it, dude.
Just so that people don't think this is a freak accident.
Right.
I'll tell a story.
Not like random at all.
This is not something that he does all the time. So, and I don't understand this. I don't get it because technology these days, like I understand in the 50s and 40s when you're like,
My old 56 truck, like I had issues issues with it, but it's because it didn't work.
Okay, so where were we going?
Spartan race.
Okay, we were going. We were driving.
Yeah,
all of us. Adam's driving, and literally, this is this is like modern times. Runs out of gas.
Yeah,
on the freeway.
We were just so confused. We just like stood outside. Like, wait, what happened?
We had to pull over and throw a football around while we waited for the gas because we ran out of gas. So here's the question I have, because I've noticed, I don't know if you guys have noticed this, there's two kinds of people, literally two kinds of people in the world. There's the people that see that their tank is like getting past a half and they're like, I got to get gas.
Yeah.
And then there's people like you that only get gas when that shit is like to the very end.
Yeah, yeah.
So what is it? Like, why?
You know what it is because.
Do you just hate getting gas?
No, I don't mind getting gas. But I'm always trying to time it with what I'm doing. Oh, do I need to go pee or do I want to drink or am I hungry? Like just to pull over to get gas, I feel like is a waste of time. It's like such a waste of time to just pull over for gas. It's like I need to be doing something else also. I need to be having to go to the bathroom or eating or we have to stop and grab something. So I'm always trying to time it with stuff like that. Or I'm always trying to time it with an exit that you just pull off and you go to the gas and you get right back on. Because I'm so like the time guy. Like I have my Waze app. I'm trying to beat the time the whole time. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So I
drove. Who are you racing?
Myself. I'm competitive with myself and everything that I do.
You just wanted to get there. I know you.
I am. I'm like,
I got to get there. And that's all you thought about. Because I was thinking we were going to be stuck in traffic forever. And so I had like flashlights. I had like extra food. I had all this shit. I thought we were going to camp out. And so we went and we stopped and we got like filled up again. You know, and then I got in the traffic.
Have you seen those videos making fun of dads where it's like, you know, the morning of our to get on a plane at 11 a.m. or something like that. And at 6 a.m. dad's up with the suitcases lined up with his coffee. All right, guys, get ready. That's you. You know, let's go, guys.
Let's go.
Let's go.
I am definitely like that for sure. I'm also the guy too. You know, the other meme that's going that was going viral this break also was the Christmas one with dads in the trash bags.
Oh, I love that.
I'm totally that guy too.
As soon as someone starts,
get the trash bag out. We like station them.
Continue.
Yeah.
Okay, that's hilarious.
Yeah.
So I'm opposite. I get gas. I almost never go down below a quarter. So as soon as it gets to a quarter, I get, you know, down to a quarter
the
empty.
Same. Yeah, a quarter for me.
I think because we have because of technology and we now have it to where you can measure it down to the mile, I think that causes me to push it more. I didn't run out of gas when I was a kid. When we didn't have those gauges and it was just like the light that comes on and you weren't sure if you had 8 miles, 12 miles. Like I was good about getting gas back then. I never ran out of gas as a kid. But once that came out, it's kind of like the navigation thing. Like I used to be great with directions, but I've become dependent on
because
it.
Because you see the miles.
Yeah. So I'm like, oh, I'm fine. I still got 7 more miles. I'm cool. You know, I'll get a gas station sooner or later. So you push the limits.
Was that the only time you ever ran out of gas with us in your whole life?
No. Well, we've done it twice. I've ran out of gas twice with you guys.
Yeah.
Wait, hold on.
Yeah, there was another time. What it was.
With us?
Yeah, there was twice. Remember, because you gave me shit because it was the second time. You're like,
oh my God.
Yeah, there was another time.
You did.
Yeah, there was, I can't remember where we were at.
We were traveling. Was it in Austin? No.
Yeah, it might have been a rental car. I don't remember what it was.
I think it was a rental car. Yeah, it was a rental car.
This is hilarious.
Yeah, no, I pushed the limits.
You did.
Yeah, and I never used to do that. It's just because of the tech now. And again, and I am that guy who does not like, when I'm ready to go, like I want to make a trip. Like we drove back on Sunday or Saturday night and we left after dinner. So it was a late drive, right? So it's a 4.5 hour drive home with no traffic. And we left at 7 or something like that. I remember what time we left dinner, somewhere around 7 o'clock. So it's going to be late for us to get in. And I mean, I had to pee the last hour and a half, and I like would not pull over. It's like, we're going to make it. You know, I'm going to make it all the way there without stopping.
Yeah, one time I had to pee hella bad, and I played that game, and then there was nowhere to pull over.
You peed yourself.
No, I didn't, but I almost did as a grown man. You ever almost pee yourself as a grown man?
Yeah. The time we were in the limo, I remember like going up to San Francisco. I forget what it was for, but like, you know, we were going up. I think it was for like your girlfriend at the time, like Natalie. Something was doing something up there.
Oh,
you
just want to say what it is. That's
what it was like a lingerie thing.
Playboy lingerie party. Yeah, that's what it was.
Anyways.
This guy is like, wait a second, do I want to talk about this?
I just started drinking, and I was drinking a lot, and I seriously felt like my bladder was going to explode, and I didn't have any control because I wasn't driving. And so I'm just like trying to kind of bring up like, hey, anybody else need to pee? Hey guys, anybody else like need to pull over? And I'm like, I gotta pull over. And then he finally found some like back alley thing and pulled over.
Yeah, that's when you pee and you actually make sound as you pee, like,
oh, yeah. How, it's like razor blades.
How long had you and Courtney been together?
Hold on, that's an STD, Justin. Sorry to break it to you.
You and Courtney were together when we went on that, was it? Or was that before Courtney even?
Yes.
You're trying to get in trouble.
But I just got, I didn't do, I was a good boy.
Do you remember who that, it was, you remember the three girls that live with Hef that were really famous?
Oh.
You know who they are, right?
Yeah, the blondes.
Yeah, the three blondes. And I can't think of their name. I know, right? No, but you know who I'm talking about, right? I can't think of their names right now. Doug, you know
Kendra is one.
Yes, yeah. That is one.
Yeah.
Kendra, I think Brittany and another one, I think are the three.
Kendra's, you know what's funny? You could just pick, those names would make sense. Yeah. I don't even know, but I would, Brittany, that's definitely one of them.
It was her Holly, Halloween, right? Yeah, Holly, isn't it? Holly, Brittany, and Kendra, is that right?
Kendra, Crystal.
All of a sudden, Adam's got a picture Holly. Memory. Now he always says he doesn't
Justin was like looking at me, the limo, and I'm like, what limo trip did we go to San Francisco with Natalie? And I'm like, oh, shit, I forgot all about that party.
Yeah.
I remember that, now. That's crazy. That was a good time.
We both threw each other in the bus on that one. I'm sorry
This is before Mind Pump, so I don't even know what's going on. All right, so here's something that got my, I don't know, I'm, this is personally, gets my cackle smile a little bit.
Oh.
Yeah, it makes me smile. So we're in the middle of a new wave of, you know, of illness, and it's exploding everywhere. Nobody cares. I'm out.
Yeah.
I'm going out.
Yeah.
And places are more crowded than ever.
Yeah.
And I think it's because two things. I think because this new strain, we're getting lots of data showing it's mild, this new variant. But also I think people are just over they're just over it.
And if they're wearing a mask, it's like down here. And I'm like, what do you, like, why?
People are,
why are we even doing this?
People
still?
Seemed, and you guys saw that the White House statement, did you guys see that? That this cannot be solved at a federal level. You know what that means, right? That means midterms are coming. We see the polls. We're going to get crushed.
People are over it.
We got to leave it up to the states type of deal to decide what to do.
Man.
And I want to say this is, I feel very, I know shit's kind of crazy or whatever, but we've got it, boy, our forefathers are founders, right? Not perfect people. They're flawed like everybody else. But boy, the way they designed things was brilliant, because the state system and the court system. The
division of power was essential.
Slowed down a lot of these, what I would consider big overreactions that you still see now. Massive in Europe and other places.
Yeah.
And it's not happening here as much, and people can just, you know. So to me, I'm glad that people are like, I'm just going to do what I think.
Is Australia still in like full lockdown?
Hard.
Still.
A lot of places, very hard.
I know, I saw Canada.
I'm getting messages from people like, I can't work out again.
Canada's crazy too. Yeah, there's other like countries in Europe that are still like super aggressively locking down.
Yeah. So two studies that came out were interesting. One is confirming what other studies are showing. I'll get to that in a second. Another one showed that quercetin, so a lot of the wellness people have been saying for a long time, take quercetin with zinc. Mm-hmm. To help with respiratory illness. So they've been, you know, recommending this. Well, the study came out showing that that quercetin probably has some benefits for people who have COVID. It's what I recommended everybody. We don't have it here, but I recommended everybody. Well,
I mean, I definitely took some of the glutathione to my parents actually got sick with the vid. And so I went over to hand that off, and it really did help kind of with the recovery.
So glutathione is the other one. So glutathione, I'll read this particular study, but glutathione, they're showing in a lot of these studies, here's one, endogenous deficiency of glutathione as the most likely cause of serious manifestations and death in COVID-19 patients. NAC raises glutathione levels. That was shown to be beneficial. And then glutathione, one of the problems with glutathione is when you take it orally, it gets destroyed and not absorbed.
Yeah.
But now they have liposomal glutathione. So Livon is one of our sponsors. They have liposomal glutathione, which means it's encapsulated in a liposome, which is a fat, which allows it to bypass this destructive process in the digestive system to get to the cells that need to use it. And there are studies that show that liposomal glutathione does effectively raise glutathione levels. So this is probably a supplement that you'd want to have around and take during, to just prevent, serious illness.
Now, do you know how that compares to because they use it in like the nebulizer too, right? Don't they?
I don't know of any studies with that, but lots of anecdote. One of my good friends back when the Delta strain was the prevalent one, which was that the Delta comparison to Omicron, Delta seems to be.
Yeah, Delta was more aggressive.
Yeah, like way more severe symptoms, but less transmissible. Omicron seems to be super transmissible. It's like spreading like crazy.
This is the most people I've I've ever known at one time to have it. So I probably have 15 family and friends that have it right now.
I'm gonna say, look, I'm not an expert.
All over
on this, so I want to preface this by saying I'm not an expert, or whatever. So it's just based off of the data that I've read and from the epidemiologists and virologists, and they have said a long time that the evolution of viruses typically follows this path, where eventually it becomes less deadly because it's not beneficial to a virus to kill its host because then it can't spread.
Right, where's it gonna live? Yeah.
Yeah. In fact, did you guys ever play that video game? What was it called? Pandemic, I think it was called. Where you can create a virus and see how fast it spreads in the world.
They made a video game?
That's for like it's evil an old kids, game. Dude. I didn't know that.
It's an old
maniacal
app.
Little kid. Really?
Yeah, I was like 10 years old, maybe wow, less.
Bill Gates that. Make that?
But it's made by Microsoft.
Microsoft.
Yeah. But anyway, in this game, it was pretty cool. It was a simulator, and you would create a virus or a bacteria with specific properties. Well, when you first get on there, and the goal is to infect the whole world and kill as many people as possible. That was the goal of the game.
Oh, my God.
Hey, listen, before this all happened, right. It was perfectly fun. Now it would be like you wouldn't want to make this game. But anyway.
Yeah. Now you're on a list.
What a lot of people do when they play this game, and it's a simulator, and it was really cool, you would initially want to make the most deadly virus possible. Oh, I'm going to make the best virus. I'm going to win. So you'd make this super deadly virus, but it would kill people so fast, and governments would react so quickly.
It wouldn't spread.
It wouldn't spread.
Yeah.
So you had to balance. You had to make something that was super transmissible and whatever in order to get this. So it was pretty cool. Anyway, this is what happens with viruses. So they predicted, many of them predicted, that this virus would eventually become far less deadly but way more transmissible. Mm-hmm. And then I read an article about there's a current cold virus, common cold virus. So I'm not sure if it's a rhinovirus or another coronavirus that today causes the common cold. It's been around for a long time. But I believe in the 1800s, it caused a pandemic in Russia, killing many people. So it mutated to become the common cold. But when it first became a thing, it killed lots of people as well.
Well, wasn't that one of the theories from the very beginning?
Yes.
That this was going to turn into like a common cold that we have every year? That's why, too, we're probably going to see a flu shot all the time.
Yeah.
I mean, every year, that's what
you're going to see. I don't know. But it's maybe too soon to say. But this could potentially – I was reading this. There was this – I think it was a virologist was writing this. And he said this could be – the beginning of the end. Basically, it's so transmissible. So many people are going to get it. And then they're also going to get lots of immunity. And it looks like the variants now are moving in this direction. I mean, maybe a little too early to tell.
I'll just keep crossing my fingers.
Yeah, but I mean, this could be kind of, because I know too, I know lots of people with this.
This is the most at one time that I've seen. And all but one, it's been like super mild.
Dude, have you seen the reversals that that government, I'm going to pull some of these up.
Tell me if this is true or not, because I'm not diving into this stuff very much anymore. I'm like so over it. But I did see something, and I don't know if it's bullshit or not, that they're finding that it's being transmitted more through people that have the vaccine than people that don't have the vaccine.
We have to be careful.
So I know there's gonna be a bunch of people butthurt over that statement.
No. This is super early data coming out of other countries, and in the early data, it still hasn't been peer reviewed, but the early data showing like 4 times higher, 8 times higher if you're vaccinated. Yeah. Now here's the problem with that.
2-4%.
Yeah, we don't know if that's because vaccinated people feel like they're
fine
more. Yeah, so they're out more stuff and less. I don't know.
Yeah.
But that's what's
happening. I'm sure that can play a role, but 8 times is quite a bit. I mean, right? I mean, it's not.
It would be weird, right? Yeah. But so check this out. Here are the reversals. It says here, like, and these are the ones that are listed. So now they're saying cloth masks, totally waste of time. There was actually CNN now has had an expert on there saying, yeah, cloth masks basically
CNN actually putting that on.
Yeah, they're saying like you need to use the N95, you can do anything, but the cloth one's total waste of time. They're of course vaccinated now, could spread and get it. The death rate now seems to be total comparable to the flu. Natural immunity is actually very effective. We have to take into account societal needs. So now we're seeing this reversal.
What do you mean by the death rate comparable to the flu?
When you're looking at the total of what's going on, the death rate is moving lower and lower, and it's looking more comparable to what you would get from the flu.
Well, the criticism out there is the early treatment, right? That wasn't being promoted early enough, right?
Yeah.
And they were just, there's some weird thoughts about that, like why that wasn't like promoted enough or why there wasn't like movement there a lot, you know, to you know, provide that.
That's one of the theories why the death rate is going down, is because now people are getting told.
That's the reason why, like in the beginning, why we had like high numbers of people getting like severe symptoms.
Yeah, the monoclonal antibodies are really effective. The drugs that we can use to treat COVID are really damn effective.
Is that the one that that was banned in Florida or whatever?
It wasn't banned in Florida, but it looked like the access
to the supply. Yeah, somehow.
Weird. I don't know why that doesn't make any damn sense why that would happen.
There's
anyway.
There's so many shenanigans that are going to come to surface. Like, I'm just holding back until all this is completely confirmed. But there's lots of, people behind the scenes, like in CDC and all these major organizations, that there's some fuckery.
Speaking of that, what's going on with Ghislaine Maxwell or whatever? Did she got nailed on five out of six accounts?
Yeah.
So
what's crazy?
What does that mean?
So I don't know. I don't know what the sentence is going to be. But I looked. I was on a forum and people were talking about the case or whatever, and I was like, isn't it weird that none of the details were made to the public? I'm like, that's fishy, right? And then someone went on there who's got a background in this and said, actually, one of the reasons why the public didn't see a lot of these details is maybe this is leading to other investigations. So they don't want to compromise.
Of course. Right. You don't throw all the details out.
Yeah, so maybe the details, and they kept them private because now it's spurring deeper. Because remember all the rumors, lots of rumors of like really powerful people who are connected.
Well, that was my concern, was like, yeah, okay, she serves time, but like, does that case get completely like shut down now and they move on, or are they going to keep pursuing all the other people involved?
Who knows, right? What is this saying, Doug? Is this saying what happens next? Yeah. Up to 15 years in prison.
15?
No, that's 65 years.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, yeah, that would be... Yeah.
Even that.
65 is better.
Yeah. Well, dude, all the people that could potentially be connected to this. You are talking about one of the biggest upheavals that I could imagine.
Yeah, worldwide people in power.
Well, I get why there was no coverage inside there to compromise, but it's kind of crazy that there's just not a lot of TV coverage about it, like talking about it.
Oh.
I feel like that's such a big deal, and that, like, you're right that it could.
But this is it's been a weird few years. Like, UFO shit's coming out. That's crazy too. Nobody cares. I mean, I'm serious. People would have freaked out who was it? Didn't the Air Force? Oh yeah, we definitely, you know, see things and admitting stuff.
Yeah, but all that to me, like, it just seems like just, you know, I don't know how to say it, but not like psyops, but it's like, it's a way to like mislead people from other like events and things going on. You know, like, I look at it as a way to kind of like steer public, you know, like them like being interested in something away from, you know, a really important thing we all fly
for. So I can go there for sure. But there's this saying that's, if there's hoof prints in the sand, think horse, not zebra, right? So in other words, always think the most so if we go with the Occam's most obvious razor thing, I think it's that people are more hyped and afraid about things that can affect them personally. So of course, COVID, right? That's the big thing. Oh, I'm scared about that. And then, you know, like when September 11th happened, oh my God, we're going to get attacked and, you know, we're going to get killed or whatever. So that's what I think. And I think that humans are so social. We're such social creatures that you have individual mental, for lack of a better term, illness. So it's not really illness, but, you know, maybe distortions in how you view certain things. But there's also group distortions that can amplify.
Oh, yeah.
And I think we're going to look back. This is my prediction, and it's being recorded, so I hope I can play this back one day. I think we're going to look back and say, greatest overreaction in all of history.
Mass hysteria.
We caused more problems than we solved with the way that we reacted. Not discrediting that there wasn't a pandemic.
I don't think so, because least in the my family and friends that are like divided on this still, they're still divided on it, even with all the new stuff coming out and saying Macs are useless. And I mean, it's still, I don't think that
we're so indoctrinated.
Yeah, I think everyone's been drinking their own Kool-Aid for so long on both sides that I don't think we're gonna go look back.
I think it's gonna take a while, but I think we're gonna look back and be like, holy cow, we created this much debt that causes this problem. Look at the children.
You already see the turn in that, though, with the Biden administration and everybody else. Like, they're starting to totally sing a different tune. So I think if more leaders start singing a different tune, it's going to make you look back at it and be like, wait a minute.
Listen, all those signs are already there, dude. I don't know. I don't, at least I don't see that in my circle of people that are on one side and the other, like both sides feel like, I feel like everyone dug their heels in already.
Totally.
Everyone already dug their heels in.
Yeah, I know. Again, everybody makes their own personal decisions. And so nobody wants to be like, I was totally wrong.
Yeah, but hold on. I don't think it's going to happen 5 years from now. I'm talking about decades from now, a decade or two decades from now. So the best example
The reason why I'm saying that is this. There's the people that, let's say, that have gotten all three shots right now, and we're seeing that the death rate's going. A lot of people think it's because of us overreacting that has dampened.
No, that's not what I'm referring to. I'm not referring to that. I don't think. Who knows about that?
What part of overreacting are you referring to?
Lockdowns, mandates.
Yeah, but I think a lot of people believe that has aided us in slowing down everything.
So here's why I think why decades from now we're going to look back. We're going to look back. We're going to see, oh my God, suicide rates went up so much. Depression went up so much.
We already see all this already.
We do, but we're too close to it. Yeah. So we're too close to it. This is the best example
I can give. You needed to like shit on it is what you're saying.
I'll give you my example. So the best example I could give is September 11th. September 11th happened, scared the shit out of everybody in America. And we literally invaded a country that had nothing to do with September 11th. We invaded Iraq. And if September 11th didn't happen, no way they would have had public support.
No weapons of mass destruction.
Now, at the time, you had lots of people being like, no, we need to go. And you know, there was public support for it. Now, today, there's hardly a politician that will say, oh, yeah, that was a good thing that we did. Now, that was how many years ago, right? It was 18 years ago or 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. So I think decades from now, we're going to look back and be like, oh, man, we did a lot of damage to people and to kids and to schools and education and to obesity doubled its speed and drug overdoses.
There'll still be countries though that'll keep riding this because of somewhere like Australia where they have such full control over this lockdown and this power grab. Are they really gonna want to reverse that given new information?
I don't. I think it's gonna take political pressure. We have midterms coming up.
Yeah,
this is why. Always remember, right before an election, politicians sound exactly the way you want them to. And they say a lot of the great stuff that you want to hear. And then, of course, once they're in and they're like, all right, we're cool, then they go back to doing, kind of what they want. So I don't know. Anyway, I wanted to tell you guys. So you guys know I'm a big supplement pusher, especially with the products that we use, right? So I was giving people Pure to family members over the holiday. And
Merry Christmas.
People raving.
Do you know that's what? So I actually did that. So I have a couple nephews that are in their 20s and they're like big into lifting and stuff. And I actually think it's totally cheesy that Katrina does this. She says, don't. They love it. I'm like, that feels so cheap for us to give like our sponsor stuff. And like she literally, I don't know if you guys noticed,
just
but
she, on the back
she came in here and like rated everything. Like she got we had all this, like people gifted us duffel bags and like all these different. Yeah. So she, for Christmas, like boxed up like a duffel bag with like all the different supplements that we have.
I'm sure they loved
it. Oh, they did. They absolutely.
Well, I mean, I'm guilty of doing that with stocking stuffers because stocking stuffers are kind of like your very last.
Yeah. Okay. So I feel that's just like, this was a present. Like you open it up. Like all of our supplements and stuff. Yeah. But I mean, in her defense and the way she defended herself in this, she's like, listen, that's like $200-something, $300 worth of supplements right there.
And they like it.
Yeah. And so I'm like, all right, fair enough.
Now, are they giving you feedback on Pure? Because my family loves it.
Yeah, they do.
They love it.
Yeah. Everybody I've introduced it to really likes it. So I think it's that and green juice. Green juice isn't my favorite. Like I like the way I feel from it. It's just I use it the most. Those are the two out of Organifi that I use the most consistently.
Speaking of lifting, though, another interesting, and I'm thinking of this because I know that we're going to air this episode, and then the day after, I believe, maybe Doug can correct me, on the mind pump, Mind Pump Hormones Forum or is it MP Hormones?
No, it's Mind Pump Hormones, and actually it's going to be tomorrow.
Tomorrow. Okay, so Mind Pump Hormones Forum on Facebook, which is open to everybody so far, although we may be closing it soon because it's getting flooded with lots of people. One of the doctors from Regenerative Sport and Medicine is going to get on there, answer questions at 5 p.m. Pacific, just live. So you can ask them whatever question about anything related to
They've
hormones.
They've been crushing it on there.
Yeah. They crush it. And so I've been going on the forum and asking them questions, and I'll tag them, Todd or Dr. Rand or whatever. And one of the things that I noticed, which is wild, and I've been talking to you about this, Adam, and because I think you had the best feedback, is about 5 months in, my metabolism is so fast that I cannot eat enough, which I haven't experienced since I was probably in my early 20s. I think my metabolic rate increased by 1,000 calories, which is insane.
Yeah,
I'm just eating, and I can't seem to.
I miss that. That was one of my favorite things about being so consistent back in competing days. Was I built up that metabolism to where it's like it was. I mean, it's a double edged sword, right? Because if I didn't keep up the calories and eating like that, then I would start to lose weight, and some of that weight would be muscle. So, and I of course was trying to hang on to all that muscle.
That's what happened to me.
But the positive side is like, you know, I eat 1,000 calorie dessert, ain't no thing. Like my metabolism is roaring so much that.
That would be my problem, would be like being drawn back to cookies and everything else, because it's like, yeah, whatever, I just need calories.
Well, I had to, right? So I, you know, that
you have to search the hyper palatable food. Yeah, if you can't eat more.
Yeah, when I was pushing over 5,000 calories, I don't know too many people that can honestly eat 5,000 clean calories every single
day. That's okay. To put that in perspective, that's 5 1,000 calorie meals.
Yeah.
So that's 5 big ass meals,
and 5. Like you do that in chicken thighs and rice, you know how much that is? Like 1,000 calories of that? That's like
your grocery bill is probably hilarious.
Yeah, no, it was crazy. So I would have to throw in like desserts, you know, and think peanut butter and the oils and butters and things. I would need that in order to boost the calories up because I just couldn't get to 5,000
I'll push 4,000 calories and I know the scale won't really move much at all. This week because we were, you know, hanging out with people and I'm not as conscious about feeding myself. My calories probably got down to 3,000 or less, and I lost like 3 pounds. And I'm like, so I asked Dr. Todd because I've gained roughly probably about 13 pounds of lean body mass. So I'm like, okay, I know the more muscle burns more calories, but there's also a calorie burning effect from, I think, testosterone on its own. So I think it's both because it doesn't, it's such a big difference, dude. Yeah. It's like over 1,000 calories more that I'm burning all the time, which is really wild. And so I went on there and I asked
everybody
him about it.
Everybody hates you
right
now. Huh? I said, everybody hates you right now. Well, I remember I used to never like talking about it because I would just get the dirtiest looks when I tell people.
No, I'm glad you said that.
Yeah, I can eat whatever I want.
No, I'm glad you said that.
My holiday belly right
now. I don't want to give people expectations that are not realistic. So I think I'll say this. I think this is more fair. My tendency is to have a faster metabolism anyway. And when I was a kid, I had such a fast metabolism. It was comical. I could eat like 7,000 calories and just nothing. So I think what it did is it kind of brought me more back to, you know, how I was. So I don't think if you're if you gain body fat super easy, you'll get a faster metabolism, but you're not going to end up in the position
with that.
I'm in. But I have a tendency to go in that direction anyway.
That was the experience I had too. Okay. As a young kid, I had this roaring metabolism as it was. And then it felt like when I was taking testosterone, back when I was competing, I had gotten back to those days of like.
Well, studies on TRT show that men who are on TRT, so they obviously bring you from low levels to high normal levels within range or whatever. They don't, not working out or anything, will lose body fat and gain muscle. So the hormone itself directs your body to do that, even without additional exercise or anything else.
Well, I think this is the reason why so many, you know, steroid guys are terrible with their advice because they're like
they're not the same.
By default, they just build muscle, right? I mean, if as long as they lift some weights and they can get away with eating a lot, they can eat kind of like an asshole and still put on good lean mass and not put on a lot of body fat. And so a lot of their advice comes from their experience and what they're doing. And it's just like, that doesn't work for everybody. You can eat like
I remember
that.
We were talking to, was it Pekulski? Ben Pekulski?
Yeah.
That was an eye-opening moment because I said to him, I said, man, pro bodybuilders must have the best digestive systems in the world to be able to eat as many calories as they have to get as big as they do.
Yeah.
And he goes, no. He goes, the best bodybuilders have genetics to where they don't have to eat a ton to gain muscle. I'm like, oh, that makes perfect sense because who could eat 10, 12,000 calories a day every single day? Yeah. You know, you wouldn't be able to.
I mean, that's why I think 5,000 a day is crazy.
Yeah, there's no way for me. There's no way. It would, my gut would get so many gut issues trying to force feed my, it just wouldn't make sense. Hey, real quick, you got to check out Ned. They make hemp oil products, high CBD hemp oil products, but are full spectrum, right? So they're full spectrum cannabinoids, all the beneficial cannabinoids you find in hemp are in their products, and they're really the only ones I've ever tried that I actually feel. I've tried lots of CBD products, and I notice nothing. Like, I take them, and I'm like, is there really CBD in this? Is there really something going on? Not true with Ned. I take this And I notice I have less inflammation. I feel calm. I feel good. I feel really good on their products. And they have much more than just that. But you got to check them out. They're really, really cool. We love working with this company. Head over to helloned.com/mindpump and use the code mindpump for 15% off. So you get a discount just because you used our code. All right, here comes the rest of the show.
First question is from Luke Nichols Fitness. Is it best to do ass to grass every time for squats, or is it better to mix it up a little bit for someone trying to get stronger and put on more muscle?
All right. So when they say ass to grass, they're referring to just a really full squat, right? All the way down. Is that better? Okay. First off, the fullest range of motion that you have complete control and stability of is the best, general best form of squats for yourself. And this is true for any exercise. So, but the caveat is control and stability. Do not go beyond the range of motion that you fully own or control, because the risk of injury goes up real high. And then the risk versus reward doesn't make any sense. So let's just imagine that you could go all the way down and you have beautiful technique and full control, full stability, and that's how you can squat. Is there still value to doing shorter reps or partial reps or shorter range of motion? There are, but really for specific reasons. Like if you're training at a part of the range of motion where maybe you have a sticking point.
Yeah, sticking point or athletic reasons, really, for performance, where you want to generate the most force. Like, yeah, you see this with basketball players a lot, like, you know, going all the way down in an ass to grass squat doesn't really make that much sense. They're not going to be generating a lot of power like that as they're playing. So trying to mimic a little bit more, like, so it translates better to what they're actually, yeah, you know, producing out on the court makes sense. But in general, I think that shooting for a deep range of motion is a good goal to have. But you know, working your way there and maintaining that stability and control is everything. It's crucial.
It's funny. This is only a question for squats.
Yeah.
Think about that for a second. Nobody asks you that in any other exercise.
Yeah, curls. Yeah. You never heard anybody say
even
that.
Even deadlifts. Yeah. Shoulder presses. No one's asking, should I not go full range of motion
maybe
sometimes?
Maybe bench just to touch the chest. You know, I get that question sometimes, yeah, but yeah.
No, you're right. It's squats. It's about, you know why? Because squats are challenging,
yeah,
and most people have issues with mobility, control, and stability doing a full squat.
That's, and this, right, is why, the reason why I think this question comes up a lot is because I think that—
Can I avoid it?
And I think you inherently know the answer if you're asking this. Like, I think that if you're squatting ass to grass and your form sucks going ass to grass, you probably shouldn't be squatting ass to grass. You should work on your mobility to get to that place, and you should squat down to the depth that allows you to squat down to with perfect form. Mm-hmm. So hopefully that's getting down to ass grass, but more than likely it's not, and you have to work towards that. So whatever range of motion you can do with perfect form is what you should do.
Yeah. And I don't squat ass to grass. I lack the control, the stability, and the,
exactly,
mobility to do so. So I squat parallel or slightly below parallel. That's just what my body allows, and I'm not willing yet to take the time to really work on continue, but I still work on it and try and get it a little lower. Now here's the question. People are like, well, what about aesthetics? You can still build muscle. Like, yeah, you can. You can still build muscle and get great aesthetics. But the question here is more about comparing the two. And truth be told, if I could squat full all the way down with the same control stability that I have going, let's say, parallel or below, then I would do the full one, because you're going to build more muscle. You're going to get a greater range of motion in strength, or greater application of strength. You have better functionality. It maintains joint health a lot better. The issue really becomes about if you don't own that range of motion. And that's true for any exercise.
I just think, like, so in a hypothetical situation where you have like a really low seat, for instance, and, you know, all you've been training is like this certain degree that you've been sticking with in terms of like squat depth, where all of your strength, control, and everything is focused on like just like that degree of angle. And now you go below that, you know, what tends to happen? You get all this instability, your body, you know, loses its sense of control. And this is where it becomes a problem. And this is where something like, you know, you find like situations where you're in pain and, you know, an injury might occur. Mm-hmm. So it just in terms of thinking of overall function and longevity, I think it's something to consider.
Yeah, no, it's 100% around that. It's about what's best overall, not just what's best for specific applications. Specific applications are specific, but it's true for any exercise. They've done lots of studies on this. Full ranges of motion, all things being equal, are better than shorter ranges of motion.
And that's for every exercise. Every exercise. But we only get this asked on squats. And I think it's because there's something inside these people that are doing this that are telling them, like, maybe I shouldn't do this all the time because their form sucks. And and I see people doing that because we talk about the benefits.
So they force themselves to go all the way down.
Yeah, so they force themselves to go all the way down. And it's like, if you're squatting, and just because you can, it doesn't mean that you're doing it with good form.
Correct.
So if you can get down to ass grass, but then your chest is all the way forward, your shoulders are rolling forward, like your back's rounded, you know, like if your form looks bad in that position, then you don't have good control there.
You know what, Adam? I like to say good control and like full control and stability over form, because a trained coach or trainer can see it in form. The average person can't see it in form. They'll see two squats.
No, you're right.
And they'll say, oh, it looks like a good squat. Unless it's obvious, right? They'll say, oh, it looks like a good squat. It should feel to you like you own every single inch of that movement. Like you could pause at any moment and hold it and be stable. Because what happens to a lot of people when they force a deep squat who lack the control and stability is they'll go down, and then past a certain point, they kind of like go down and come up.
Right.
Like they lose stability and then come back up. And like, oh, I could do a full squat. It's like at the bottom there, you lost control and stability.
They can't dig their way out.
Yeah, and as soon as you push the weight or you're off a little bit, that's going to cause an injury. So that's the issue. It's not the deep squat. It's the fact that you can't do it with good control and stability.
Right.
Next question is from Marie in Motion. What are some social media tips for personal trainers wanting to demonstrate their process to their followers as Adam did?
What are they referring to here?
I think they're referring to my transformation whole journey, right? So documenting, maybe that's what they mean by process.
Like trying to show it in an authentic way or?
Oh, yeah.
I think that. I talk about this when I get on podcasts like with other trainers, and and one of the questions I've been asked is if you had to start all over again, Mind Pump doesn't exist, and you turned on your Instagram and you were to start building your online presence, what would you do? Or would you do anything different? Or what would it look like? And I say, yeah, it would look a lot different than what I did. You know, what I originally did, I didn't know what the fuck I was doing. I was taking pictures of my cars, my shoes, anything to get eyeballs on me. And that was like, I was just trying to get attention because I didn't know what to do yet. Looking back and now what I've learned of building a presence on social media, I would have actually done it completely different. And as a trainer, what I would do is I would cater to my people in person. So the clients that I'm training, even if that's one or two people, that's it. It doesn't matter. Like, or if I've got 20 clients, however many clients you have, the content I'm going to put on any Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube is all going to cater to my in-person clients. And what I mean by that is I trained Susie at 8:00 this morning. Susie was complaining of knee pain. So we foam rolled her IT, we did some hip mobility stuff, and we got to the bottom of it and had something to do with her instability in her hips, and us working on the mobility alleviated some of the pain, right? And so I would create a post that speaks to that exact thing, right? So one, now my client Susie has a reference. Oh, that was that thing that Adam taught me that I'm supposed to do when my knee starts bothering.
Other people can relate to it.
That's right. Yeah. And then other people that may also be experiencing the same thing can get use from it and maybe see benefit. And now I look like I know what I'm talking to those people that need that specific help. And now I'm attracting the perfect client for me.
Yeah.
And so I would continue to make posts that are related to what I'm already currently going through and what I'm learning. So if maybe a client says something that I'm not familiar with, this has some sort of condition that I've never trained before, and I go, I'm not sure, let me find out for you. I go home, I start Google searching and looking up and trying to research what is going on and how can I help this person, and I'll probably learn something. Whatever it is that I learn, I then make that into a post or a YouTube video or something to, again, compliment them and then grow.
Something you did, though, I want to give you a little bit of credit because I know, obviously, when we all started, we kind of just threw things up and you were the first one really to do that. But something you did do that I thought was very different and very brilliant in the sense that it would stick today just like it did back then was you were not always trying to be super flattering and whatever in your posts. In other words, you would post these progress pictures of yourself.
Yeah.
You wouldn't get a pump. You weren't posing. You weren't trying to have the best lighting. You used your bathroom mirror flat. You took the picture. You were very honest about your diet, what you're doing. You were so honest to the point where when you got close to competition, I think it was like the 3 weeks or something or the 2 weeks before, you said, now I'm entering into, because I'm going to tell you guys what I'm doing. Yeah. I'm going to be very honest, but this is the unhealthy stage. Nothing that I'm doing now is healthy.
Yeah.
Up until this point, I've done everything in a healthy way, but in order to look stage ready, there's things that I have to do that are unhealthy. And you were very honest about what you did, how you, you know, modified your water and your sodium, stuff that you would never recommend to the average person. That I think was really cool. And what it would, at least for me, because this is before this, we started Mind Pump, but we didn't know each other super well. I remember seeing that kind of stuff and going, I would follow him because I know he's honest.
Genuine.
Yeah, he's not bullshitting me.
Well, I think that's the hard part about the whole thing is because all you see is like a disingenuous post of people trying to lift themselves up in their best self. And yeah. Then also like, you know, when they're having a bad day, they'll cry and they'll take a picture of them crying.
Oh my God, what is that?
It just drives me crazy because it's just like...
Have you ever thought to take a picture of your face while
you're
crying?
Never. No, nobody ever would. That's a real person, right?
And so let alone
post
it.
That's all you see, though, is like these... Well, I have to capture this because my followers think, you know, they think in this with this weird distorted reality of like what I need to portray. Just portray, like you said, there's... things that you can notice in your clients that you're training that people can learn from and find value from, or yourself, you know, that you've been able to understand, you know, more in depth, or something that you can relay that has value to people. That's what you need to do. Stop with this whole like glorifying, you know, how you look or projecting yourself in some weird, inauthentic way.
Yeah, be authentic. And I think what you guys are referring to, what you see now, because when I did that, by the way, like I wasn't aware of anybody else. That's what made me do that, right? So when I looked at all the other people that were showing before and afters, and I like right away, I'm like, oh, this guy, I could tell he's pumped up.
Yeah.
I could tell he's got some professional light on him. I could tell he's shooting with a great camera. And I'm like, that doesn't really give us an idea of what his body's really changing or doing. And so my idea when I did that, it was original then. It's not so original now. Now everybody's figured this out that, oh, wow, be more real and be more trans to the point where people are trying to manufacture authenticity, right? And that's what you see with the, oh, let me take a picture of my
popular.
So yeah, let me take a picture of my period stain and show people I'm human too and I have my period. Or, oh, I'm crying and I'm sad. Let me get my phone and record that now. This is me being authentic and vulnerable. It's like, no, it's not. Like, this is you trying to manufacture authenticity. If it's real, it'll just be real. Be yourself. Be real, be vulnerable. And what vulnerable looks like, I think, from a trainer's perspective is not knowing and being comfortable with that and being okay with this and presenting yourself like that, that this is something I just learned. Like, that's how I coach trainers that are up and coming, that are new, that are nervous, like, I don't know very much, or I'm still, that's okay. Like, present that. I
always say that even.
Yeah, I always give that analogy of the waitress,
refreshing,
right?
To hear that from
people. When you go to a restaurant and a waitress comes over and she says, today's my first day, so bear with me. I'm still learning the menu.
Yeah.
What ends up happening? You're incredibly patient. And in fact, what you end up doing is you look at like, oh man, she did a good job on that considering it's her first day. Mm-hmm. You like give her the benefit of the doubt because it's her first
now.
Versus her pretending like she knows everything or she's been doing this forever and then she fucks up on your order and she fucks up on this and then you're pissed because she portrayed that she'd been doing this forever when really it's her first day. Same thing goes as a personal trainer. If you're still learning all this stuff, it's okay for you to be transparent and say like, man, some great information that I just learned, and credit the person you probably learned from and teach it and share it with your audience. You'd be surprised how well that will do.
It's so bad that I remember, I'm not going to say too much. I don't want to give away. I don't want to try and crap on this person, but I remember this was a popular social media fitness influencer. And we were in this place and around them in a gym with them, whatever. And they worked out and I watched their workout while I'm working out and checking it out and like, oh, okay, that's cool. They do that, whatever. Then they posted their workout and the volume that they posted in the post was twice as high as what they did in the actual workout. And the weights that they said that they did were not the same at all. I'm like, what are you doing? You're not helping anybody by doing that. And what's funny is that the mentality is, this is going to build my business. Actually, it's not, because people start to get onto it. They don't believe you anymore. But if they think you're authentic and real and honest, then if you try to sell something, they're going to be like, oh, I believe this person. They're not full of crap, you know? So it's funny because we think being fake is more effective. It's actually not. Not only that, but I can't think of a worse hell to be in than to actually be successful being fake. Could you imagine all these people loving you,
people like this,
and adoring you,
yeah,
for who you're not,
yeah,
that would be a terrible feeling.
You get a bit of anxiety-ridden people I've met.
You get a bit of a false signal with the whole likes and comments game,
yes,
you know, and the way the algorithm is, it works, right? The algorithm, it gives you, gets you higher ranked on like explore page, yeah, when you get more likes, more comments, and more traction on there. And so people tend to do things that's going to give them more attention and attraction. Doesn't necessarily mean they're going to give them more business. And I learned that the hard way, like through the process of turning this all on, like that's when I first did, I didn't knew nothing of what I was doing. And I was like, I was just watching what other people are doing. I'm like, oh, okay, cool stuff. I see people doing, yeah, cool shit and I'm cool. Like, okay, here's my cool car. Here's my cool shoes. It's like getting likes and little hearts and like, okay, I'm on the right track.
Plant emojis.
Yeah. So I've got, you know, I'm starting to get thousands of people paying attention to me, but I'm not seeing the conversion to dollars in business because they're there for my cool shoes or my car, yeah, or because I look good with my shirt off. Like they weren't there because I could help them and I'm in the business of helping people. And so you got to be careful not to fall in the trap of trying to feed the algorithm to get attention, but it's not what you do for people. Yep. If you have a service that you're trying to provide, then that's where I would post along those lines. And I learned that the hard way over years of trying to figure this whole thing out. And so if I were to go back and do it again, I would not post nearly as much. I would post when I learned something.
It's or like
when
that
I
go girl that something. Had, what did she have? 2 million followers, launched a t-shirt line.
Yeah, like 30 shirts.
Like, yeah, or like $100, something, yeah, like that. Like, great example.
Next question is from Chavez Edwin 1500. Is there anything you can do or take to make your veins pump like Sal's?
Yeah. Of course you like this question.
Yeah. That's a great question, dude.
Those other ones, dude. This is awesome.
I'll send you some. Let me send you some. These are the supplements you need to take. You ready? No.
Yeah, let's get it.
The key is to do bicep curls in the bathroom.
That's all the time. I go to the bathroom right now. No, you know what? It's funny that this question actually comes up a lot. We've been asked this question.
No, of course. I used to, actually, this is a very common question. I used to get asked a lot as a trainer. Normally if you're somebody who's not very vascular, you really want to be, right? Especially a guy, right? Guys love being vascular.
It seems like guys, yeah.
More so. There's some girls that I think that dig it too. Yeah, yeah, for sure. But I mean, it's mostly guys that are-
I'm into vascular girls.
And very vascular.
But most of it, first of all, like many things, a lot of it is genetics. So either genetically you're like, even at a higher body fat percentage, I'm still like, I consider myself at a higher body fat percentage right now, but I still have- you know, vascularity right now.
Same here.
And then when I get really lean, so that's the other thing is how lean you are, right?
That's the big one. I just have my forehead and get angry.
Yeah, that's the big one is getting lean.
Yeah, I would say genetics one, lean two, right? Because even someone, I've seen people that are shredded and they don't have very many veins that are popping.
No, I get them on my arms and my shoulders. I can get them on my quads. And then the leaner I get, they pop out. So it's leanness makes a big difference. That's a huge one. And then, you know, are you well hydrated? That's another big one. Like I notice if I drink a lot of water, especially if I drink now that we work with Element and I use their electrolyte powder or whatever, that made a big difference in my vascularity. It actually made a big difference in my pumps in the gym as well.
Is that the sodium? Is that what?
Yep. Yeah. Yep. Yep. It's better electrolyte balance. I needed more sodium because I don't need processed
food. It was a performance enhancement for me for sure.
Big time.
Using it.
Supplements, can they improve vascularity? I mean, I guess technically you could take things that boost nitric oxide. They'll say things like arginine or citrulline, pycnogenol. That'll boost your nitric oxide. That's not a supplement you hear too many people talk about. Pharmaceuticals might do it. PDE5 inhibitors like Viagra, Cialis. Although that'd be a weird reason to take those. Like I just want to get more veiny.
But isn't that all just like a temporary effect, right? Like it really gets getting lean and then the genetics. If that's all.
That's
really
what I'm saying. Those are the two big ones. Either you're and even someone. So someone who doesn't have a lot of vascularity, if they get really lean, you'll have some vascularity. Most people get like somewhat vascular when they get really lean. And then if you're somebody who tends to be a little vascular, right, and you get lean, you'll get really vascular. So those are the main things that are going to make the difference. All the supplements, to your point, Justin, is
some people get really crazy looking, weird, not like cool looking vascularity. There's some bodybuilders like Paul Dillett from the 90s.
Like worms invaded their body or something.
Yeah, he had really crazy looking veins.
Mark Bell's invaded that to me.
Who?
Mark Bell's.
Oh, he's got
Mark's got that worms all over.
Yeah, and then there's a bodybuilder now, Walker, I think his name. I think he just won the Arnold Classic. He's got these crazy looking veins in his lower body. So genetics does definitely play a big role.
Yeah.
But anybody, you get lean and you'll see them more. So there's really no... hate to tell you. I mean, I wish there was a supplement that really made a big difference with this, but
I know nurses love guys with like crazy vascularity.
When I get
my blood, they're like, I stab you.
When I get my blood drawn, it's a comment I get every single time. Yeah. Oh, cool. This is easy. Yeah, yeah. I actually had one tell me that try to make a dark joke, which I appreciate because I like dark humor. Yeah. She's like, oh, you would work real well with heroin or something like that. Yeah, I'm like, oh my God, what a terrible joke. You're a
real good heroin junkie.
I started crying.
Yeah, you'd make a great heroin junkie. Yeah. You know, I was thinking the same thing, actually.
I appreciate that. Yeah,
funny you say that.
Next question is from everyone's nerd. What's a good metric to know I'm gaining muscle and not excessive fat?
Body fat test. Nerd. Consistent body fat tests is the best metric that I can that will tell you that. You got to do them the same time, one week apart,
same method,
same feeding beforehand and after. You know, make sure everything's as equal as possible. The body fat tests of choice would be underwater weighing is probably the most accurate or consistent. The calipers would be the next one with the same person testing you, by the way, because people have a little bit of variance how they test.
Those bod pods are pretty accurate.
And the electric impedance is probably the worst.
Most accurate, but strength and waist, like you recommend a lot, I think. Yeah.
There you go. I was just going to say, because a lot of people are like, well, how do I test
body fat? Yeah, I'm not going to take body fat every single week. It's going to be so hard.
If your strength is consistently going up and your waist size is going down
or staying the same,
you're probably gaining right muscle track. And not body fat, I would say. Yeah. That's probably the
cheapest. Deepest, easiest way to consistently check on it, right? So not everybody has access to a skinful calipers or a body fat test machine or whatever like that. And so even though that is the best, that is the gold standard, that is what I used to use when I was tracking and really diving deep into all this stuff. But I mean, you could easily just check your waist. And if your strength is going up and your waist is staying the same or shrinking, like you're
in a pretty good position.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, years ago I did, back in the day I used to do these really aggressive bulks. This was my 20s and I'd go hard and I would eat everything and I'd get my body weight up. Like right now I weigh about 206 maybe and I get my body weight up to like 230, 235 and it wasn't lean. I will never show a picture, by the way, of these. So maybe if you guys ever have them, you guys should show them.
I think you Google search it.
But I look like a meatball. But anyway,
I have some in my library.
But anyway, I remember I didn't track my body fat or muscle, but I was getting stronger relatively consistently, but I didn't measure my waist. Now, here's the challenge with that. Strength can also go up because you get better at exercise, you change your training. And fat actually, in some lifts, improves your leverage.
Yeah.
If my waist grows because of body fat, I can often squat more as a result for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. So when I finally did do the body fat test at the end, I found that I gained 30 pounds on the scale, but like 7 pounds of lean body mass. So it turned out to be a fat bulk much more than
I remember how discouraging that was because I did that for years. That was like the method, get crazy bulk and then try and get lean afterwards. And I remember the first time I did the dunk tank where I did a huge bulk just like that. I was up 230, 240, and then cut all the way back down to like 205 or whatever. All the gain, like 1 pound of muscle.
Yeah.
Like so discouraging.
Put your body through
the whole lean muscle takes such a longer period of time. I think people realize.
Oh my God. And then so easily goes away when you're living in a caloric deficit and doing cardio and doing everything you can to burn. And that was part of when I learned that whole lesson, even with cardio and stuff, was like, man, you go so hard, you gain 20 pounds, 25 pounds on the scale, you know, all in the pursuit of building muscle. And then you go cut back down and I end up with one more pound of muscle than what I started with 6 months before with all that hard grinding and dieting. I mean, that's crazy where you could have just gradually done it and easily accomplished the same thing.
Yeah. So waist is good for women. You can go waist and hips. Only problem with hips is your butt will grow. So that can change that. For men, waist is actually quite reliable. If you measure your weight, you know who taught me this, by the way? Mm. Doug.
Oh yeah.
Doug as a client came to me and we started working together. And I used to do circumference measurements on clients all the time. But Doug's like, oh yeah, I measure my waist, I don't know if it was every day or every week. And as long as it stays around the same, you know, then I know everything's going good. Especially I'm like, oh, absolutely. If you look at the studies on this, you can actually, it's not going to be nearly as accurate as body fat test, but of all the other metrics that you can do that are easy and cheap, for men especially, waist measurement will predict fat gain or loss.
Age, right?
It's totally.
Like, yeah, no, I like
most
that.
Of body fat.
I like pictures too. I know they're much more subjective to do.
You're so objective. That's why it's good for you, though.
Yeah,
you're good at being honest with.
Right, them. And I would take. So I would my clients. I used to actually make them take photos every Friday, and then what I would do is I would show them, like, you know, I'd wait like 4 weeks so they could see. I could see it week over week if we're making progress off of photos. But then I would point out areas, like, see this area right here? See where you were holding more body fat? Look how you're leaning out here. Like, because they'd be like, I don't feel like it. I don't feel like I'm changing at all. Sure you are. Look back at this picture right here 4 weeks ago. Look at this week's photos. Look at this. And then I would point out the differences between the two. And then they would, oh, okay, I see it.
I did that for a short period. I actually had a female client that was so, like, stressed out about whether or not she was gaining or whatever. So we did the same thing. And she was so upset because her jeans were getting tighter and tighter. So I pulled up her pictures and I showed her the difference between the two. And I said, and it was a side shot of her. And I drew on it. And I said, here's your butt here. Here's your butt here. And she's like, oh my God, my butt's like 2 inches higher. I said, that's why your jeans are tighter.
Yeah.
You built some butt. So that can be effective. You just have to be objective. The problem with pictures is people are so often distorted with how they view themselves that it's hard for them to make that, especially week by week. It's really hard to tell. Look, if you like our information, you will love mindpumpfree.com. Head over there and check out our free guides that can help you with almost any fitness goal. You can also find all of us on Instagram. So Justin is at mindpumpjustin. Adam and I have been shadow banned. So you have to type in our full name and kind of have a tough time finding us. But we are there. So I'm found at mindpumpsal and Adam is found at mindpumpadam.